very first Easter was not a crowded worship space with singing and dancing. On the very first Easter, the disciples were locked in their homes, dangerous to come out. They were afraid. They wanted to believe the good news from the women that Jesus was risen, but it seemed too good to be true. They were living in times of despair and fear. If they left their homes, the lives of their loved ones could be at risk. Could a miracle have finally happened? Could real life have won out over death? Could this time of terror and fear really be coming to an end? Alone in their homes, they dared to believe that hope was possible, that the long night was over and the morning had broken. God's love was the most powerful of all, even though it didn't quite seem real yet. Eventually, they would leave their homes, and the fear and the danger subsided. When celebrating and spreading the good news of Jesus Christ's love was the most powerful force on earth. This Easter, we get experience of taste of what that first Easter was like. Still in our homes, daring to believe that hope is on the horizon. Then, after a while, when it's safe for all people, when it is the most loving choice, we will come out, gathering together, singing and shouting the good news that God brings life after death, and love is the most powerful choice. This year, we might have the closest taste of what the first Easter was like. Would you join with me in worship on this Easter morning?
I'm singing this morning a tune entitled This Easter Celebration. You will all recognize the tune written by Samuel Wesley in 1864. The new words you will recognize are very appropriate to the situation we are now in, and they were written recently by Carolyn Gillett. Thank you.
is from Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 10, titled The Resurrection. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.' So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. 'Greetings,' he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me.'"
Just want to say happy Easter. I'm so excited to be with you all. No matter what the circumstances are, I'm glad that we have the technology and the opportunity to do this. I miss you all so much and I can't wait to be back. That being said, today I want to share a children's story with you because it's important that we all remember to worship even when we can't be together. So today, it's such a happy day. Why? Because it's Easter. Happy Easter. I know that right now we all have a lot of emotions. Sometimes we're frustrated and we're angry, but today of all days is the perfect day to be happy because he's risen for us. The story I want to share with you guys today is about how Jesus rose from the grave. It's something we've all heard and we all know, but it's something we should all be reminded of. While I read the story, you guys at home, give me the emotions on your face. We're all feeling a lot of emotion right now. So how do you think the people that knew Jesus and loved Jesus felt during this story? So to begin, it was early in the morning on the first day of the week when some women went to visit the tomb where their friend Jesus had been buried. The women were very sad when they went to the tomb. When they arrived at the tomb, the women discovered that the stone that had completely covered the entrance had been rolled away. Can you imagine the look of surprise on their faces when they saw the open tomb? When they looked inside the tomb, they had the biggest surprise of all. It was empty. Suddenly, their surprise turned into fear. You see those scared faces. Two men in bright shining clothes came and stood beside the women. In their fright, they bowed down with their faces to the ground. The men spoke to the women and said, "Jesus is not here. He has risen. Don't you remember what he told you when he was in Galilee?" Then the women remembered what Jesus had told them in Galilee, and they were no longer afraid. Their fear turned into happiness. Let's see those happy faces. Yay! And they went back and told Jesus' disciples what they had seen, and that Jesus had risen, just as he had told them he would. What a happy day. Now, I know it may not seem like it right now, but you and I have so many reasons to be happy today, don't we? We're happy because we know that Jesus rose from the grave and that he lives forever. But we're also happy because we know that the Bible tells us whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. Now that is something to be happy about. Let's see all those happy faces. Now, even though I can't hear you, please repeat after me in prayer. Dear Father, we are happy today because Jesus is risen from the grave and lives forever. We are also happy because we know that those who believe will also have everlasting life. Amen. I can't wait to be back and see all your lovely faces and hear all of your lovely laughter. But until then, keep your spirits up.
I'm reading from Psalms 118. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. Shouts of joy and victory resound in the tents of the righteous. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. The Lord's right hand is lifted high. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. I will not die, but live, and will proclaim what the Lord has done. The Lord has chastened me severely, but he has not given me over to death. Open for me the gates of the righteous. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation. The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The Lord has done it this very day. Let us rejoice today and be glad.
Amen. the third chapter of Colossians. Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory.
Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Christ is risen. He has risen indeed. In the text that Barry read for us today, we recognize in Colossians, those who are living were made alive in Christ. We are raised in Christ according to God's viewpoint. When Christ was raised, Christ is risen, he is risen indeed, God considered all believers, past, present, and future, to have been raised with him. We are no longer dead to our sin, but alive in Christ when we put our faith in Jesus. Because of Good Friday, Christ dying on the cross, taking on our sins, and allowing us to be reconciled with God Almighty to have eternal life. God calls us to become in daily experience what God says we are already in Christ. We are peacemakers, compassionate listeners, truth tellers. We have a heavenly power to be full of joy and peace, compassion and goodness, kindness, gentleness. Colossians 3 verse 2 tells us not to set our minds on earthly things. And I know it is impossible not to think of earthly things in times like these. We must still take care of the daily day operations and obligations and activities, even as our world has paused. Lots of things are canceled, but laundry is not canceled. Making dinner has not been canceled. Our once in a great while trips to the store for toilet paper or milk, learning to do our jobs in different ways, trying desperately to be patient with our kids as we help them with e-learning, itching to be outside when it's just a bit too chilly, and baking bread to defeat isolation. I believe that we are all longing to be with our people, our family, our friends, our church community, even on this day where Christ is risen. He has risen indeed. We know Easter is different, being holed up in our homes. And if we're honest, we are a bit afraid of what life would look like when this virus is over. Will jobs come back? Could we possibly again begin to dream about taking a vacation beyond Des Moines County? What will health insurance look like? Even in these worries, we rest in John chapter 14, verse 27, Jesus speaking to us. I leave my peace with you. I give you my peace to you. I do it not give it to you as the world does. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. When we're honest, we are a bit troubled, and maybe even a bit afraid. This fear, as the disciples were afraid on that first Easter morning, in this fear we have a choice. We can choose to focus on our fear, or we can consciously choose to set our minds on God, the waymaker, the miracle worker, the light in the darkness, because Christ is risen. He has risen indeed. We are called to set our minds on something that means to make our heart's central focus. The Apostle Paul knew that we would have a tendency to focus on earthly things and feelings, but earthly things must not be permitted to take precedence
over the things of God, God's word, God's service, God's praise. Today, our attitude can be one of mourning on the things that we can't do. We can't go on Easter egg hunts. We can't eat a nice ham meal with our family or neighbors. We can't retire now this year. We can't travel on our bursary. We can't. Or we could set our attitude on those things in heaven. For in verse 4, Christ is your life. When Christ appears again, you will also appear with him in heavenly glory. Christ is risen. He has risen indeed. When our gatherings are the most loving choice, we again will come together and celebrate out of our homes, into the pews, bravely proclaiming in the darkest of days, we chose to believe in the one who rose from the dead, just for you and just for me. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Psalm 27, verse 14. Be strong. Don't lose hope. Together, we wait for this virus to change, to mutate, to die. And in our waiting, we know our hope is secure. We know our salvation is assured. And we are choosing to have the attitude of Christ. For Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. On this Easter morning, I would ask that you might take a moment and shake off the earthly woes and focus on the joy of the new morning, the promise of a new day. Ground your attitude in Christ Jesus. Be kind. Be gentle. Pray for all the kinds of leaders. And let us make a way on this day towards Christ Almighty. The church is not a building. The church is its people. And on this Easter morning, we are not in our building, for we are in the community, in the kingdom of God, in our neck of the woods, as we make a difference, as we proclaim, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Amen.
Would you pray with me? Almighty and holy God, we thank you for giving us Easter morning, for giving us Good Friday, where Christ died, was buried, and then on this day rose again. We pray for anyone who is afraid, who is weary, who is longing to step out of our homes and in to the company of others. We thank you for heeding to the loving choice of being physically distant. God, on this day, we pray for those who in their sheltering are not in a safe place. We know that you are a refuge and we can find strength underneath the shelter of your wings, but when our rooms are not safe, it does not seem like we know what to do. Help us as neighbors, as colleagues, as teachers and parents, to know when to have compassion and when to step in to help those who are hurting. We pray for all those who have the virus, including Denise Johnson's aunt and relatives of Roger and Sue Stoffaker. We pray for those who are grieving in isolation, Carolyn Nelson and Vicki Wishmeyer, over the death of her daughter. We pray for those who don't have the personal protective equipment they so desperately need to be medical servants on this day. For all those who have lost jobs and are wondering when insurance will kick in, we pray for hope, for light, for help. We pray for leaders near and far that they might pause, take a breath, recognizing what they say impacts so many. And God, as we desperately long and cry out to you, we thank you that you are our hope, that you give us light, that you are our salvation. And as the news continues to weigh us down, give us courage to turn it off. Crack open the Psalms. Read the Gospel of Luke. Call a neighbor in need. As we join together in the prayer that your Son taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Easter greetings I give to you. Call up someone and give Easter greetings to one that you love. For Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. So let us go into our minds, into our homes, and believe that Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. And let our choices reflect that. This we pray. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Christ is risen. He has risen indeed.